Hi there, this is Toby Green and you're listening to The Green Room with Tom Green and Jacob Gaynor. Stay tuned.
Oh, coffee's for a week for that, mate.
Welcome back to the fifth instalment of In The Green Room. Thomas, how was your break?
It was fantastic, thank you, Jacob. It was nice that our buy coincided with Easter. Such a lovely time of year, so it was nice to be able to get home. I went back to Canberra for a couple of days, which was really, really nice. Got to see some mates. It was kind of bizarre, actually, because my family wasn't even in town. They were down in Melbourne seeing my extended family, so without training on Friday, unfortunately, I wasn't able to make it to Melbourne, so it was just Canberra for me, but it was lovely. It was a lot of fun. What about yourself? How was Newcastle?
It was great. Reconnected with a few old mates.
Yep.
They're avid listeners of the podcast and were pretty upset I didn't name and shame.
Really?
So, yeah, had a fantastic weekend with Nick and Liam. had a great time and they'll enjoy that one. But, really enjoyed it. And it's an exciting episode, Tom.
It is an exciting episode. It's really exciting.
Because last week we teased the guest.
We did. The CEO.
The CEO was your teaser. I'm not going to lie to you. It was a pretty massive hint. And a lot of people got it straight away.
Did they?
They did. It wasn't very subtle.
Well, I guess it's, if anything, I would say it's sort of speaks to his notoriety, our guest's notoriety, and how interested they are in him.
Okay. But it's pretty exciting because similar to when we had Jake Riccardi in the studio waiting to come on.
He's here waiting.
This person is just waiting.
And the other reason, though, and I want to make a really quick point of this, is every single week I've received feedback off our CEO here, who's about to join us very, very shortly. I've received feedback on the episode. He's the number one fan of the podcast so far. Like, I can wholeheartedly say that. He loves it. He's been dying to come on. He's been so energetic all day. He's been electric at training all afternoon. I've never seen him do weights with more intensity than that. He's been absolutely chomping at the bit to come on. And so it's an absolute pleasure that we can welcome on Connor Idun to In The Green Room.
Connor Idun!
And here he is.
Here he is.
Before we get to it, I've got my intro ready.
Have you?
Yeah, I've got my intro ready.
Go.
Our next guest on In The Green Room. He has such a fascinating story. He's gone from one of the last picked in the 2018 draft to one of the first picked for the Giants week in, week out. His story truly is remarkable, and we can't wait to find out more about his rise to the top. He gave himself the nickname CEO, and he's 16 followers off 10,000. Please welcome Connor Idun.
And here he is.
I'm actually getting a bit emotional, boys. Big moment for me. Obviously, biggest fan of In The Green Room, so thanks for having me.
It's nice. It's nice to have you in front of the sign too. I think it pays some nice homage, and I think that our viewers at home, we've obviously got our avid listeners, but our viewers as well, which I think you're a viewer, is that right, Seek?
Definitely.
Yeah,
I watch on YouTube.
Exactly. The viewers at home will learn
visually.
Yeah, just like the Seek Green, it's pretty face, and obviously you're a nice smile game. So.
Yeah, this is already pretty...
It's exciting. Yeah,
the chemistry's off the charts at the minute.
This reminds me of U10 Science.
If this does go well, I'll probably start my own podcast.
What are you going to call it?
You know what I hear? He's using this. All I hear is he's using this, Tom.
That's all right. I'm happy to provide.
We'll get into your story because it's pretty remarkable, as I mentioned at the top. But before we get into it, we, as Tom alluded to at the start, we addressed you as the CEO. That was the teaser for the Giants fans and AFL fans and general podcast fans because we're fourth on Spotify. So talk us through the CEO nickname. And what it represents, what it means, and where did it come from?
CEO came from, Isaac Cumming. So Cheesy Boy started calling me CEO one day, Chief Energy Officer. As Greener said, I've got a lot of energy, but probably since that day, no one's called me CEO apart from you boys and the fans. So I do not call myself that, and no one else calls me that. But I'll take it, to be honest.
He's quite good at the nicknames, Isaac Cumming.
Yeah, he's very good.
Yeah, he's the best.
He's very, very funny. Like, as everyone who knows Cheese... he's a very, very funny guy, very quick-witted and just good at picking. Like, it's actually a real skill and art picking nicknames that stick. Like, it's really hard, I think, but he seems to do it regularly.
He's done Toby Bedford Snooze.
Yeah.
That was him.
Yeah. He also came up with Seek.
Yeah, he did Seek.
Yeah.
Yeah, talk us through the second nickname, which is probably the more common nickname. Mm.
Well, he got that in literally probably 20 minutes of me being at the club. So he just put Idun Seek together. And then, yeah, sounds like hide and seek. Yeah.
It's so stuck. Clever.
No, he's unbelievable. So he's actually really good at them. He also, I mean, it's not really that original, but I was greeny up until I met Cheese, who dubbed me greener. And now that's just what it is.
I got a podcast with children today. Now, Seek, we mentioned your story. So do you want to, I guess, start at the beginning? In recent weeks, your story's kind of come to light a little bit more. Pretty keen to dissect it and get a little bit more of an understanding. And I know Giants fans and the likes are, but born in London.
Yeah, born in London, so Essex, Chelmsford to be exact, with mum and dad. And then obviously they went their separate ways. So when I was 4, moved back to Australia with mum. Sort of bounced around everywhere. Lived in Kellyville for a bit out west Sydney.
Can we claim you as a Western Sydney product?
Oh yeah, I bleed for this West Sydney, so 100%.
She does.
And then, yeah, moved to sort of Frankston for a bit. And then Geelong, which is where I did most of my growing up, obviously.
You wouldn't remember much about England at all?
Nah, I remember not much at all, but keen to get back there, actually. Now that I've sort of rekindled with my dad, it'll be good to get back.
What from your early childhood do you remember? Like, where's the first place you really connected with?
I remember a bit about sort of Frankston. I went to primary school there, so year prep and year one. And that's probably the first memories I've got.
And then to Geelong?
Then to Geelong.
What age was that?
I was 7 in Geelong.
And what was it like growing up in Geelong?
Yeah, it was really good. Obviously, primary school, sort of used to ride my scooter, Maggie Pro, to school every day. go to the skate park every day, have a nice Savin batter, if you know what that is.
No, what's that?
You don't. It's like a hot dog.
Savin batter?
I think like it's a deep-fried
hot dog.
Yeah.
Deep-fried hot dog.
So it's what Americans call a corn dog. It's just a hot dog on a stick that's been deep-fried.
Yeah.
What do you call it?
Savin batter.
Savin batter.
Savin batter.
I'm going to call it a corn dog.
I don't think it is a corn dog, though.
I'm not the same.
Can you explain it?
It's a dead set hot dog deep fried.
It's a hot dog.
So a corn dog. Isn't that what a deep fried hot dog is?
Yeah, so that's what I'm trying to say. They're just different names for it. Because it's like a saveloy in batter.
Saveloy.
Yeah, saveloy. It's a savin batter. But anyway, a savin batter corn dog, they're the same thing. He was banging them.
$1 in the morning. So one of them before school and then one after school.
Wow.
Can't go wrong.
What were you like as a kid?
Thick.
Like, were you still cheeky?
I was cheeky, but I was thick, as Grana said. A bit overweight. I was pretty cheeky, but sort of kept to myself a bit, apart from my own sort of group. Yeah, pretty much.
And then when did Aussie rules kind of come into it?
At primary school. So, mum didn't let me play Auskick, and then my stepdad wanted me to play rugby union. So, I played that till maybe 14.
Rugby union?
Rugby union.
How'd you go?
I was terrible, and I was scared of it. No other way to put it.
You know what I'm actually surprised is, honestly, in country Victoria, I can't believe there was a rugby union comp.
Yeah, there was Geelong Rams, and then we played for everyone in Melbourne.
Yeah, right.
Versus them.
There you go.
So you played both, or you transitioned?
I just played rugby and then moved to footy. I did 1 year under 12s, and then under 14s is when I started properly playing AFL.
And what age did you go, I'm a draft prospect? How do you go from this thick kid eating deep fried hot dogs to a prospect?
Probably 17 and a half is when I...
That's late.
Nah, to be honest, I really started loving it. Yeah, ages 15, 16. I was a Cats fan, so I went to every game. But chances of being drafted were pretty slim for a long time.
And so you have a very close relationship with your mum. How was she through that process? And was she an AFL fan? Or was it completely new to your whole family?
Nah, she loves AFL. So she was a Pies fan. Which stings.
Not anymore.
But now, obviously, Giants fan. But she was really good, driving me to every game, supporting me, giving me a slap on the back of the head if I played terrible. So that's what we love about mum.
And then, so a Geelong Falcons product.
Yep, Footy Factory.
Coming through the ranks. And then you mentioned that you didn't really think the draft was on the radar for you.
Yeah, I was a bit sort of off the pace. So I guess under 16s was nowhere near it. Didn't really try a whole, really hard. But under 17, started getting a few games for Falcons. And then, just played that lockdown defender role. Probably averaged about 5 touches. 3 really big spoils. But, kept applying my trade there. And then under 18s, the coaches sort of got behind me, said, you're a little chance here. So I just kept applying my trade. And then so the rest is history.
So I did some research today. I'm a late preparer. I did some research, I'll be honest with you, today, about now before the show. I did some research on you, and basically, so Geelong were one of the clubs interested in you, a local product, obviously, and Geelong came and they wanted to sign you to the next generation academy. And basically, they thought that they had you, and then the loophole was that your dad, Zach, of Ghana descent, was actually born in the UK. So you, and to be, to qualify for the next generation academy, he had to be born in Africa.
Yeah, that's right. So we signed pretty much all the paperwork and thought we had it done, which at the time was pretty exciting. And then got the phone call saying it's not going through because, yeah, the reason you said. So actually a blessing in disguise. I've ended up here and haven't looked back.
Was initial, like, did you want to leave Geelong?
Yeah, I was ready to get out of the bubble, sort of spread the wings a bit. Obviously, it would have been nice staying at home with the family, but I just thought if I was going to be any good, getting away from my mates eating McFlurries every day and, yeah, Zinger Box is probably good to get out of the state.
Why do you think you went so low on the draft? Are you a slider?
Yeah, can we talk about draft night? Because in this research, is it true that you were so worried about not getting picked up you didn't let anyone watch it with you?
Yeah, that's right. Mum said invite a few friends over and I said no way. That'd be pretty embarrassing. I was sort of expected to go maybe, you know, 30s, 40s. So I thought I was a sniff, and Mickey Turner, who was sort of the big dog at the Falcons, said, like, I'm pretty much 100% going to get drafted, but I still didn't believe it. And then, yeah, I said no friends. So I just had grandma, mum, stepdad at the time, and then brother and uncle. And then, yeah, it was not looking good for a long time there.
And then, so you're watching at home, I assume, and then obviously you didn't want anyone around you for this process. I mean, when the 30s and the 40s and those picks were done, like, does the heart start to sink, or what were you thinking?
Yeah, I think it was maybe late 40s into 50s, and I remember Geelong had, so pretty much it was Giants and Geelong, and then maybe one other team that I knew were interested.
Are you going to name them?
Nah, because they don't respect me, so I don't respect them. Anyway, Geelong were the last pick, and they had three picks in a row in the 50s and didn't pick me. So from there, I had the footy in my hand because I'm a footy nuffy, and I sort of threw the footy, kicked my drink bottle, and said, Mum, like, I'm done. I started walking out, and then I heard like a little ding on draft night, and it said Giants traded in. And I remember saying, please, Adrian Caruso, so, like, played into the gods above me. And then Connor Iden, Jitters, Giants.
It's an unbelievable story.
It's crazy.
You know what I think? I want to make a quick point. I reckon is real. So it is funny, and I'm sure, I don't know if these stories are going to come up, but you and I often laugh about, particularly I think for both of us, if you look at, I think we're two great examples of how much our bodies have changed since we've been at the club. And I think, is it fair to say that that's maybe part of the reason that you ended up like being a bit, is that you were a very raw prospect?
That's probably 100% yeah, of the reason why.
But the main point that I want to make, which I think will end up, I'm sure it will feature later, but is just a great point about you, I think, is that despite having those things, like coming to the game late, your body, like, not, I suppose, being as developed or AFL ready as some other players, is it your hard work and your determination. So, like, on the field, you are, like, such a competitive, determined person. And I think that's why you are where you are now, and you've forged, like, there's not many people that forge a career from pick 60s into what you've made of yourself already and what you are only going to make of yourself. And I think it's a real testament to you and your competitive spirit, your determination, and your desire to prove people wrong, which are three of the most important values I think you can have in life, but also... also,
I said he was emotional at the top of the road.
To succeed in football, I think that's just an insight for people into you as a person. Is that the reason you have been able to get to where you have is because you are probably second to none in those areas, which is, yeah, as I said, it's a great testament to you and I suppose, yeah, the way you were raised as well.
Left me speechless. That very nice words, Grana. Thank you.
Back to draft night when your name's finally read out by the Giants and. What was the whirlwind of emotions, and how did your family react as well? Because it's pretty big for a young boy to have to kind of, and rare for a Victorian product really to have to leave the state.
Yeah, I just remember starting crying straight away, sort of head in the hands and just relief pretty much. And then, yeah, family's excited. I remember my little brother was saying, like, why is he crying? Like, shouldn't he be happy? He didn't quite get why I was crying, but.
How old is he?
He's 17 now, but at the time would have been, yeah, 11, 12, I think.
Yeah.
So he didn't quite get it. Yeah. But yeah, that was just relief for me. Happy that I could go anywhere. And yeah, just grateful for the opportunity, really.
Can I quickly ask you a question as well, which is a little bit off? Gaines has his run sheet just there, but this is a little bit.
No, this is great, mate.
A little bit off the cuff. One of the things I admire the most about you, Seek, Connor, as well, we've got to make sure Seek's I know yours. Yeah.
People know now, they're listening.
Yeah, I'm glad, but I've just got to, you know, I feel compelled sometimes.
That's right. We've been, it's on brand.
It's harped. We've had that harped into us a few times. One of the things I think I admire the most about you is how proud you are of your Ghanaian heritage. Do you want to talk about what that means to you, I suppose, and I suppose how you look at that? Like, as I said, I think it's, yeah, when I look at you, you've always been such a proud Ghanaian man, which I think is an amazing trait to be so proud of your heritage, I suppose. Yeah, I'd love to hear what that means to you.
Yeah, to be honest, I think that only sort of came out when I started coming to the club, being part of the Giants, really. I guess it sort of high school and school, everyone would ask me where I'm from. I'd say Ghana, and they'd say, is that East or West? And I had no idea, to be honest. just being separated from my dad, like I didn't quite know what it meant to be Ghanaian. But as I got to the club, I think Stephen Canino is really good at embracing your culture. And yeah, everyone in the club embraced me. You know, I got really sort of inquisitive about it and what it means to be Ghanaian. You know, why do I look how I look and why am I like how I am? And I think for all coloured people, it's, yeah, embrace it and be proud of it because it's a power, really. Everyone enjoys it.
What steps did you take to learn more about it? Because I don't know how, and yet can you completely tell us to not cross that line, but
yeah.
You mentioned that you've kind of rekindled with your dad recently and we saw the footage on Roaming Brian of your dad and your brother coming to the opening round game against Collingwood. But what steps did you take to learn a little bit more about your background?
Yeah, it started with Wikipedia. Is Ghana in the West or East?
found out. Is that West or East Africa?
Well, I found out it's in the West.
Yeah.
Nah, but just from there, like, that's it. Google, Safari, just sort of looking at Ghana and then the Black Stars soccer team. Obviously, World Cups and all that, buying the jerseys, stuff like that. Seeing other boys wear the jerseys. Tubba's got one.
Yeah.
He wears it at the club. And then,
great kid.
Yeah, and then getting back in touch with my dad, who's obviously very proud. You know, he told me where he's from in Ghana. There's actually Gold Coast in the Ghana, apparently.
Yeah, you were saying this, yeah.
He's got a boutique hotel, 24 rooms, so footy trips there this year.
I was going to say, we getting there or?
Yeah, we're there. We're there. yeah, but just things like that. Just asking a lot of questions, I think, is really important and embracing it.
Mm. Nice. We'll get back to that because it was further down the track before Tom interrupted. It's all right. It's just like reading a different chapter of a book at a time. But we'll, back to following the draft, so now you're at the Giants, and there was something that, looking back at your background a little bit and going through, the number 39, sorry, where did that stem from and why did you continue to pick it? Because you wore it as a junior.
Yeah, I did. So had it at Drysdale Hawks, the local club for a bit, and then just by chance got it at the Geelong Falcons. And then when I heard it was free at the Giants, I jumped all over it, 39, just continue that. And then just through Instagram, someone must have commented on one of the posts and said, you know, if you put the alphabet comparison of 1, 2, 3, so A's 1, B's 2, C's 3, so on. So obviously 3 equals C.
9's
and
I.
And then 9's I. So wow. It works out. See, I think you're
That's cool. I didn't know that. Yeah, that is cool.
So yeah, that blew my mind when I heard that about 6 months ago. And then that's now my reason why.
Who's the best 39 in AFL history? Do we know? Like, is it already you?
In AFL history?
Yeah.
He sure was number 39 at the Pies.
Oh yeah,
I've got
yeah,
nothing on that. Yeah.
So he's got a flag there.
Flag. Yeah, okay. Got a bit of work to do, games. But
we didn't play 300 games there. But
what number was he here?
23.
Yeah. But I hold the record for the games at
Giants.
Giants. Yeah.
Tim Moore came before me, and hopefully I'm doing him proud in the 39.
I'm sure you are.
But yeah, what was it like arriving in Sydney? Obviously, a pretty raw product as we touched on, and the final pick in the draft for the Giants. So. You almost had it all to do, and how did you arrive? Did you feel the pressure, or were you kind of just like, this is pretty cool?
Nah, at the start, just pretty cool. I was very naive to what it takes to be an AFL footballer. I think, yeah,
no more deep-fried hot dogs.
Nah, I just got KFC instead. So skinnies were pretty high to start. 2K wasn't great. Nah, but yeah, love Sydney. I sort of, at the start, we'll put in Brekkie Point all the first years.
So who was that with?
So I was in the room with Kieran Briggs and Callum Brown. So everyone was calling him Seek and everyone was calling me Brownie. That was great. That still happens. Fans always do it.
Yeah, they actually do.
How do you react? Do you correct them?
Nah, just put on the Irish accent and keep going with it.
Nice to meet you.
You handle it very well. I know I would like Giants fans to make sure they get it right, because I don't know if it irks Brownie, but I know it irks you.
Oh, it's a little bit upsetting sometimes. Yeah.
I'd encourage Giants fans to get that one, get their heads around it.
I think it's more the educational piece. Like, you can go about it and say, like, oh, I'm actually Connor Idun.
Yeah, I drop that in. I say I'm Idun.
If you hear it every time you go out to a...
Yeah, obviously it's going to get frustrating, but you're going to confuse kids if you turn around and go, yeah, mate, no worries.
Can I say that, if it's an older person, which most of the time it is, they get very awkward. Very, very awkward.
What are you?
They feel like they've had a real balls up.
Yeah. Yeah. So when did the switch flick for you? Like you come in and probably not the right phrase.
No. I know what you mean, but I know when it is, and I hope he tells a story because it's one of the funniest stories.
Well, there's a lot of stories, yeah. But we'll start in my second year. Yeah. So first preseason ever. Just went back to Geelong, chilled out. Thought I was training really hard. Did maybe two sessions of boxing, put it on my Instagram. All the boys are thinking I was flying down in Geelong. Geez. This guy's a beast. Rollback day one, 2K-er. I run a nearly 8-minute 2K, which for us at this club is terrible.
Yeah.
I was last and I got beaten by, Ruckman, all that. And then I thought the day was going bad. Rolling in the skin folds and they're about 70 when I left at 45. So I was regretting the McFlurries and the thick shakes every night. And then, yeah, Leon said that weekend, don't go out, make sure the body's feeling good. What did I do? I went out, and on the Monday after, I tore my quad. So I couldn't have come back any worse.
Wow.
It's one of the all time, when I say and particularly – I say this to Sieg semi-regularly because of where he is at now in terms of his professionalism and, as I said, what he is as a player. It's just one of the all-time stories because it's the complete antithesis of what he is now. And it's you couldn't script a football story of a young player messing up their off-season any better than that.
Yeah. How did Leon take the quad?
Terribly. So he pulled, me and all the other second years in. I don't think the first years are there at the time. Maybe
that was obviously my first year, but we definitely heard about it from a mix of the boys. And then I don't think we actually heard the rinsing that he and the other second year has got, but the high performance department and Leon and whatever called us in afterwards and said, boys, sort it out. And particularly at the end of our first year, when we was out going into our first off season, they were basically don't do what Seek did.
Yeah.
Pretty crazy to think even that second year group that you're talking about, your draft class, there are a lot of regulars now.
Mm, yeah, they are.
What? It's yourself, Kieran Briggs, Brownie,
Xavier Halloran,
and who's the fifth one? Bobby.
Bobby left. Jack Caldwell left. And Jack Caldwell.
Haley. Jack, yeah. We don't talk about that, but anyway.
No, yeah. The first
that left us.
Yeah. talk to us about your debut, because it came about thanks to an injury to a certain superstar.
Yeah, so walked in the training captain's one day. I heard rumours Jesse Cameron's not going to play. I thought he's a forward. I'm a back, obviously, so.
Probably a fair assumption. Yeah,
doesn't add up.
Probably not me. And then, I think there was no one else to choose from, so luckily Idun got the nod. And round 20 of my first year, Sydney Derby. It was great. Obviously, whirlwind of emotions, and then came out and played the next day. First contest got beaten by Dan Menzel, so I was feeling low as shark shit. We're allowed to sweat.
That'll be fine.
That's an all-time Leon quote though as well. Leon was really fond of that phrase. Yeah.
Got dropped the next week.
You got a win though, didn't you?
Got the win. Yeah, got the win. Won by 2 points. Derby and dropped win. The next week. Yeah.
And then when did you come back in?
Waited a whole another year till the last two rounds of the first COVID year.
Yeah, yeah, I remember that. So when I say similar thing, the next year I made my debut round one against the Cats. Played horrifically. Luckily, my family. Thanks, mate. Luckily, my family was there, but no one other supporters there. Got dropped. Waited, and basically, I pretty much came into the team at the same time as Seek at the back end of the year of that year.
Was there any part? And this isn't in my notes. This is just going for you, but was there any part of you in that? Because that's your third year.
Which one? The COVID year?
Yeah, with Tom.
Yeah, third year.
Was there any part of you going, I got rinsed last year, I'm not in the side this year, Like, where was your head at? Like, were you head down, I'm going to get into this team? Or were you like, oh, my options elsewhere? Or like,
To be fair to me, in that year, I was actually training very hard. And I was actually playing good footy in the Oz Kick 11v11 that we were playing. There was no NAFL because of COVID.
Yeah.
So I was playing well in the Oz Kick. but yeah, there was times there I was playing forward line for Carlton. Kicked a couple of snags and I was thinking, what am I actually doing? I need to switch on. And then, yeah, you know, unfortunately / fortunately, there was a couple of people that left the club and opened up the door for me.
And then at what moment did you start to feel like, I'm a genuine AFL player, I'm settled in this side, like I belong at this level?
It was probably pre-season after that, after the COVID year. I just remember going toe-to-toe with Toby all pre-season and sort of holding my own and thought, if I keep doing this, like, you can verse Toby, you can verse anyone, really. Yeah.
It's a good yardstick, Toby. He's a good yardstick.
I guess it probably takes us to where we're at now. And you, as I mentioned at the top of the podcast, like you're one of the first picked for the side, and there's already calls for a little blazer for this year. But yeah, how do you feel now at the level, and where do you see this side and yourself going?
Yeah, I feel very comfortable at the level now. Obviously, I think played similar games to Greener, maybe one more, so 70-odd.
Yeah, I think I'm 70 and you're 71.
Yeah, so obviously really proud of where I've got to. Game's starting to slow down a bit for me and feel comfortable. We've got a great group, lots of talent. But, yeah, our system that we've got, thanks to Kingers, that's taken us to the next level. And where do I think the team will go? I think we're all striving for a premiership and I think we can do, you know, multiple years in a row. So that's what we're striving for.
And you're obviously alongside Tom now in the leadership group at the club, and you're both relatively young, so it's pretty remarkable where you're both at. But you talk about the Connor Idun of year two, and you're coming back and you're getting injured because of the way you're going about it. Like, did you see yourself as a leader? Was that any, like, were you ever in a leadership position as a junior?
Nah, here and there. I think just naturally because of my energy and, you know, walking around the club, talking shit all the time, trying to provide energy, I guess that's to some people viewed as leadership. So yeah, because of that, I have been a leader in the past. Yeah.
What he's trying to say without pumping himself too much,
he's a very
charismatic person. Like Seeker is, you know, when you walk in a room, you know he's there and he's a great presence. He's a welcoming and energetic presence. So like he says, he's energetic, but you're also one of the first people when new people come to the club or people come in, you make them feel welcome. You make them feel a part of the group, which is maybe the hardest part of leadership, is getting people to buy into something and feel a part of something where we're all striving for one goal. And so, yeah, he's no doubt a leader. He's a natural born leader.
And I'm not sure any Giants fans watching the game against North Melbourne prior to the bye, or West Coast for that matter, would have noticed. But what I noticed sitting in the media box and watching the way you guys were going about it is there's something that's been on the agenda at the Giants for probably about 12 months, maybe longer, and that's a first goal.
Yeah.
You've just mentioned that you kicked a couple of snags back in the COVID years. I'd personally love to see a celebration because I don't think you're going to be able to compose yourself. But like, what was the game against North Melbourne? You had a goal?
Yeah, North.
We set
late in the North.
So it was unfortunate circumstances. Josh Goda for North Melbourne went down with an Achilles injury, which is unfortunate, but we all came together. We had time and we said, right, this is what's happening. Because Toby had a mark or a free kick at 50 or just outside 50.
55.
And he just said, all right, this is what we're doing. We're spreading it out a bit, opening up a bit of space, seeing if we can, and then fly through, handball receive and bang one. And so we went out. And at this point, I was playing.
I've been out.
At this point, I was playing forward for some unknown reason. And so I'm pretty much on the goal line and it all sort of unfolds. People clear out a bit of space. Toby gives it, Seeker loads it and smacks it. And I've gone, oh my God, this is online. This is going to get there. And then as it's coming on, I'm like, oh, it's just going to fall short. And there's blokes that, like, we're blocking on the line. But I think it was just touched about meter, half meter short. Seeker doesn't reckon I blocked hard enough.
I saw blokes sipping pina coladas. They did not want me scoring.
Running back doing these ones.
Did you celebrate early?
No, I didn't. Like,
were you just?
I was so scared. Everything started going in slow motion. I couldn't even see. I was blind. So
it'll be the team will be in raptures when it happens because it will happen. It'll be ridiculous scenes.
And for those that listen to the song at the when we introduce Seek, that's your goal song.
Yeah, it is. Mainly did that because I was watching TikTok when I was supposed to put it in, and that was Jordan Poole mixtapes come up to that. So I'd put that baddies. In, but if I could go again, it'd be waka waka wa, waka waka.
It's not too late to change.
We can do it.
And we've already had a few people do it.
Wow. Now, before we move into a few little segments to finish the podcast, there's a few things I want to address.
The important stuff here.
Don't look at me like you're nervous.
I know what's coming here.
10,000 followers on Instagram. How close are you?
Yeah, well, that's obviously why we play, just for the Instagram followers.
Exactly, yeah. So I think he's 20. We checked this just before he came in. I believe he's 23 short. And Seek was one of the main, I'll be honest, like, When I hit 10K, Seek and I were.
I remember you on the bus.
He popped champagne for me. We were fired up, and he was the first there getting me excited.
23 off.
Exactly. So he's been with me there every single step of the way, and I've been counting down with him too. So we've just got to get in now. I implore all in the green rooms, listeners, watchers, all Giants fans, to make sure you follow him and get him to 10K. It'll be a massive moment. And I think we have to get in there. This podcast, like, we need to get in.
Is this why you wanted to come on?
Yeah, well, well, I play footy for the followers.
All right, Tom, do you want to get into your trending topic?
I'd absolutely love to, Jacob.
Here we go. Now, you've ripped into me for having notes. You've brought your own notes this week.
Yeah, but this is, and so I have written some notes, but this is a more
guideline.
Yeah, a little bit, but it's also, I just want to make sure there's just a few things that I want to have in front of me, because this is a reasonably, I know a lot of my topics have been quite comical in the past, but this one is a little bit, I wouldn't say serious, but this is it's a complex issue that I'd like to discuss. We've got a great panel in front of us here to discuss it. I think it'll just be an important one to discuss. So obviously, I think trending during the week, of course, was the revelation about, I suppose, yeah, sort of the public finding out about the AFL illicit drug policy. My topic isn't actually about the policy itself. I don't feel qualified necessarily to delve into that. I don't, like, that's not what my topic is about. But my topic, what I think that revelation raised or exposed was a conversation which I'd like to have with us about, I suppose, society, drugs and athletes. I think it's it just made me think about, I suppose, the way all those things have used. It just raised a really nuanced issue, which I think is worth discussing. So the first point I would like to make is for the initial point that I want to make is around sort of like the drug tests and whatever. Like, I personally don't do drugs, and so I've never failed a drug test that we've had here. I've never had any of that, of course, because I don't do drugs. So if anything, I suppose you would suspect I'd plant my flag in the camp that, you know, we need to be harsher on this issue. We need to stamp drugs out of the game, this, that. And I agree with all that. But I actually think the main point that I want to, I suppose, raise around this issue is one of understanding and tolerance, because athletes, we are a part of society. We're an extension of society. We're not removed from society. So if you think that there's a drug problem in our game, I think you think that there's a drug problem in society, which is a whole separate issue. And maybe there is, but I don't think that that's something that's reserved for AFL and AFLW athletes. Like, I know sort of, again, what's been happening in the media recently, and like, I suppose the drug on everyone's lips, I guess, is cocaine. And that, I think, people think that's something that's reserved for, like, super wealthy people. Like, people, I suppose, assume that it's, oh, you know, it's young people who are getting paid very well, making dumb decisions. Australia, as a nation, has the highest per capita, so per person, cocaine use in the entire world. So that's not a well-paid AFL players, AFLW players going out and making dumb decisions. That's every single person in our society in Australia making that choice, I guess. So I think that's sort of, and I don't know what you guys necessarily want to contribute on this issue, but my overarching point is, and to quote the Bible, I don't necessarily need to make it religious and quote the Bible, but given my Marist education, I feel like there are times when I can. John, the Gospel of John, chapter 8, verse 7. He that is without sin among you, let him first cast a stone at her. You're familiar with that passage, are you not?
I also went to Maris, yes.
Yeah, but you understand the premise of that verse. You know, if you haven't messed up, then you can get into people who do mess up. But the reality is we're human beings. We all make mistakes. And I think it just raised an issue around that, I guess. Like, you know, people, I think, associate it with, you know, a lot of stuff around AFL players and making silly decisions. But I think everyone makes silly decisions. It's part of being a young person. It's part of growing up, is making mistakes and understanding that, you know, I don't know, we're all going to mess up from time to time, but that's not what, I suppose, the policy is there for. And I don't think that as a society we need to, you know, we always preach about our athletes being really accessible. And part of our CBA recently, for instance, in terms of accessibility, was that now in the change rooms after games,
media
requirement. Yeah, media can be there for an extra 20 minutes. It means we're more accessible. We're more, which by the way is a really good thing. Like, we want to be accessible to our fans. It's great for the game. But when you're accessible, there's the good. It's being, you know, it's nice to be able to be accessible to the public and be there for the fans. But you got to see there's both sides. Like, we are just human. We make mistakes. Issues that affect society also affect us as athletes. We're an extension of society. We're not removed from it. I think, I don't know if anyone, if you guys want to contribute on that at all, but
I think it's very well said.
I do too. Yeah, very well said.
Yeah, I just think it was, like I said, and yeah, I'm not going to pretend to be a genius or without fault, because of course we've all made mistakes. I just think that it's a timely reminder for athletes are a part of society, and you can't, like, we are in some respects held to higher expectations. I understand that, but we already are held to, we live by a different set of rules already. Toby can't go to a cafe without someone stopping him and taking him a photo. So, like, Toby's privacy is automatically less because of his profession. So, like, in that way, we're already held to a higher standard. I just think that things like drugs don't necessarily discriminate on who they affect or who chooses to use them, because, as I said, it's we're an extension of society. We're not removed from it. We aren't exempt of issues that are going on in society. And I think particularly nowadays, it's different to our parents' generation. It's different to the generations before that. Drug use, I think statistically, particularly recreationally, is at a higher rate than ever before. And so that's just understanding it's not just reserved for AFL players making stupid decisions. This is what, as a 23-year-old guy living in today's society, that's just what it is. Like, that's just, again, I don't partake in it. I don't like it. And I feel quite strongly about that. But I'm also understanding of the issues that confront our society. They aren't just reserved for AFL and AFLW players.
Anything to add?
Nah, nothing to add.
Right. Time for everyone's least favourite segment. ASMR. All right, you've got 2 minutes to do this.
Yeah, I have. So, Seek, I know Seek loves this.
I hate this. I hate it, but I'm willing for you to, you know.
We'll see how this goes. Over. So, exactly. So, I've got this. This was a recommendation, of course. You know, we've got loyal in the green room listeners each week who contribute with suggestions as to what we want to hear from ASMR. So, this is during the week I was recommended to do bubble wrap, which I think is a really good idea. So I'm going to give that a go. I think first of all, I'm going to just maybe pop one, two, like keep it pretty small. And then we'll see if we can't pop a bunch together and see if that's what tickles people's fancy.
Could be good, I reckon.
Mm. We'll wait and see. So I'm just going to start off here with one or two, see if it really even picks up here. I don't think that's the... There's even a little bit in, I think, this. Don't you think that sounds... But anyway, I'm going to now pop...
It's a really strong segment. it's a really strong segment.
I'm now about to punch a bump. How should I pop a bunch? What's the way? Just to scrunch it?
Just grab it and scrunch it.
Yeah.
Maybe I'll do this. Do we even hear that?
It's good.
That was a bit better. I hate the dirty looks I'm getting here.
If you have to bleep this out, you do, but that was f***ed up. That is terrible.
Can that be our reel for the week?
Clip that, Will. Yeah. Oh, let's end it with a bow.
All right, so that wasn't our strongest day.
It's the worst ASMR I've ever been a part of. That's the last installment ever.
No, it's not.
You've had your time.
I'll come up with some stuff.
Give me another chance.
Something else, please. All right, here we go. We can get to the poem, but we just want to address how bad that was.
That was dirty.
Like, I'm still thinking of it.
That's got me in stitches.
Yeah, that wasn't good stuff. But anyway, we live and we learn. Maybe I'm blaming the recommendation. Bubble wrap wasn't the answer.
Oh, my goodness. Yeah, don't blame the recommendation. Blame the segment. It's not good.
Nah, it's a good segment. Anyway, your poem, mate. All right. I'll keep this in mind when I'm grading it.
All right, yeah, so you're an avid listener, Seek. Unfortunately, didn't have too long today. I was head down in the tools researching the likes of yourself.
You've had a week.
I haven't. I tried to immerse myself within my friendship culture and group on the weekend and get away from the game.
Yapping. You're yapping, bro.
Well, go pop some bubbles, man. That's sick. That was great. All right, so it's a really short poem this week, but we'll get into it. Tom, it's been a pleasure, but you've had your turn to speak. Now it's my turn. Let's recap the week. Hopefully after Tom talking, you're all still awake. I hope all of our listeners enjoyed their Christmas break. A special thank you to our guest, Seek, but we've got an even bigger guest coming next week. So we'll save that for later. Let's get to right now. This week, Tom comes head-to-head with his friend, Matt Rao. We'll see who is the best in their draft class. Two contested bulls, one eats grass. The Suns and the Giants, I mean, there's no bigger clash. What will we do when Tassie take our cash? No doubt, gather round will be an experience to remember. We can teach the Suns a thing or two about playing in September. But Connor, thank you for giving this podcast a whirl. Hopefully this gets you 10,000 followers and finally a girl.
That did not end.
When the head hits the pillow tonight, that'll be running through.
That's a good poem. But did you say Christmas break or Easter break?
I said Easter break.
Yeah.
Because I came at you for not having a girlfriend.
I might be hearing things, but I think I could have heard Christmas break.
Yeah, you got to have people clicking back.
And dog shot.
Yeah, it was a low blow to finish.
But that's arguably the best. Seek, you can score it out of 10 as well, because I know you've listened to the previous
ones. Score it out of 10?
Don't take into account the personal attack.
No, definitely not.
Oh, yeah, okay. Let's not take into account.
You gave last week's the highest one, and that was a dead set. That's just attack on you.
I can handle it.
What was the rating last week?
Nine.
I'm telling you, that's
nine.
Not a...
What was it?
Yeah. No. No, it was nine. Last week that's was a nine. That's not a nine, though.
No, that's not a nine. For one, you called me lonely. so that drops it down to, I'd
twice
say...
Twice this year.
It was short. It was a 6.5, sorry.
I like that. I'm going six.
Wow.
Mm. You were sloppy. Admit you were sloppy. You came up exactly. Lack of prep. You didn't really think about it too much.
Okay, buddy.
Yeah. Should I co-host this with you?
Yeah, you're
kicking me out for a bad poll.
Nah, I don't. Nah. I don't.
You get a six. You get a 6.5. You need to be better.
Okay, no, it's great. Mm. I think that's it's good criticism for next week. And obviously, I'll come back with a better poem. You're coming back with no ASMR because the segment's done.
We'll wait and see.
You want to talk about a new co-host? Seek can just replace you.
Ooh.
All you need is some talent.
No,
you're an AFL footballer and you need a media personality.
Yeah, the media personality is replaceable.
No, I'm not. Replaceable.
This clown. Alrighty. Hey.
All right, that's it.
We've talked enough. We've certainly talked enough for...
We've done enough talking.
For the listeners, the viewers of this week's podcast. Thank you very much for tuning in to another episode of In the Green Room. Make sure you stream us on all major streaming services. Watch us on YouTube. And the Giants website, I believe.
Yep.
And send us around to your friends.
Perfect. Connor, thanks for coming on.
Thanks for having me. See you next week. Woo. Savvy. Good passing. It was my audio.